There have been many twists and turns in the superorganism concept since it was really developed by William Morton Wheeler at the turn of the 20th century. You know, big questions loomed. Is it a metaphor or is it an entity? Does it really help to use it as a metaphor or think of it as an entity, or does it not help? Well, certainly to William Morton Wheeler, it was an entity. And certainly to Spencer, he was using it as a metaphor on which to hang analogies. Ed Wilson, the foremost sociobiologist of the 19th and 20th century, or the 20th and 21st century so far, I don't know, he was a little bit ambiguous exactly where he stood on all of this, in my opinion. In his fantastic book, The Insect Societies, that he wrote in 1971, he wrote about the superorganism. And he said, the concept offers no techniques, measurements, or even definitions by which the intricate phenomena in genetics, behavior, and physiology can be unraveled. Add to this the continuing quest for precise evolutionary explanations of the origin of sociality and variations among the species and details of social structure, and one has an exciting modern substitute for the superorganism concept. So he was basically saying, you know, it really hasn't provided anything for us. It hasn't, this idea hasn't led to any discoveries. It hasn't helped us understand the things that are most important to understand with respect to the evolution of complex societies. So he basically rejected it at that point in time. And it went into a period where people, you know, just didn't talk about it, they didn't think about it. But then in the mid-1980s, there started to be some of a reviving of the superorganism. There are a couple of papers that were written, one of which was written by Ed Wilson, actually calling for you know, maybe we ought to be thinking about this. Maybe the superorganism can help us in understanding. And one of the key papers that came about was written by David Sloan Wilson, not related to E.O. Wilson, and Elliot Sober in 1989. And they wrote this paper where they were talking about superorganisms are real, they're entities, they do exist. And what it takes to be a superorganism are the following points. The population has to be subdivided into groups. So, I mean, one way to look at that is with honeybees, you got a whole bunch of bees out there in the population. It's subdivided into groups. We call those colonies. So there are these different groups. And they weren't saying it had to be, that it had to be insects. It could be other things. But they're divided into groups. And then the groups vary in properties that affect how many offspring groups they produce and disperse. So there's some sort of group fitness associated with these different groups that are divided into the population. So some groups, say colonies, have certain properties that make them more successful in surviving in their environment, and they produce more reproductive offspring. In the case of honeybees, that could be swarms and drones, and they disperse. And they don't stay where they are. They have to disperse, and then they remate in order for this to be a true population of groups or a true population of colonies. Variation in group fitness, the variation that you see, is actually due to genetic variation. It's not just simply phenotypic variation that's associated with things other than genotypes. It has to be heritable. So this group is better than this group at, say, surviving cold winters because it has certain genes associated, certain genetic characteristics associated with it, which it can pass on to its offspring colonies that it will produce subsequently. So it has to be heritable. And then the last thing they say is a critical point. For it to be a true superorganism, there can be no difference in the fitness of individuals within the group relative to each other. There can be no reproductive competition inside. All the elements have to have equal fitness. So, in other words, it's like the cells of our body. You know, we are the vehicle for all those cells, and we reproduce, and every cell, if you look at them as individuals, have equal reproductive success through us. So there can't be any kind of individual group or individual reproductive success, differential reproductive success within the group. And that's a tough one, because that was a very, very rigid criterion to be called a superorganism. If you look at the video here, you can see a swarm of drones flying through the air. And here's a queen who's flying along, and this group, big group of drones is chasing her. And you can see how they bump into each other, and they're competing with each other to get access to the queen. Well, and then they mate. Okay, you know, one could assume that these males that are flying through the air, some of them could be brothers. So there could be some competition for reproduction that's taking place by individuals within that particular colony. And the degree to which they compete with each other could be significant in populations where there aren't a lot of colonies, or not significant in populations where there are a lot. But at any rate, there are opportunities here for reproductive competition that is taking place among individuals within a colony. As I said before, honeybee workers can lay eggs. Under certain circumstances, their ovaries develop, they lay eggs, and those eggs develop into males. So that puts these individuals in competition with the queen mother, because this can take place in a queen right colony that has a queen. And also they're in competition with all the other individual workers in the colony who are not laying eggs. The workers in the colony actually police this activity. When they detect them, they will treat them very aggressively and sometimes eliminate them from the nest. In 2008, Bert Holdobler and Ed Wilson produced a book called The Superorganism. And this was sort of a big revival of the superorganism. This was their revival of it. You know, the two pinnacles of social insect research and authors wrote this book totally about superorganisms. It was dedicated to that. Their definition in their book is a superorganism is a society that possesses features of organization analogous to the physiological properties of single organisms. Well, this definition, when you read it on the face of it, is a metaphor that you're hanging analogies on. So if it has features that are analogous, then we'll call it a superorganism. But I don't think that the two of them really agreed on this particular definition. I know that the definition for Wilson, it was a much more open concept of what a superorganism can be. And for Bert Holdobler, it was much more restricted. You know, Bert stated specifically what his view was, that an insect colony like a honeybee colony can be a superorganism under circumstances, even though there's potential reproductive conflict that goes on inside of the colony. And there are others besides what I already discussed. But you know, what I showed before with the swarming and the egg laying workers, in the definition of Wilson and Sober, we would have had this funny thing that honeybee societies would not be superorganisms, but maybe other things are. But Bert clarified that. It's okay. I mean, what he said is there's a point of no return. That to be a superorganism, they have to have evolved to the point where the workers cannot revert to leaving the nest, forming their own colony on their own. They can't, there's no return. They can't go back. So in the case of the honeybee, you look at the queen, and you look at the workers. Workers are incapable of producing a colony. They're incapable of laying the eggs, producing the offspring that are needed to produce a full colony. And when you look at some of the ants, in this particular case, the worker versus the queen. Well, many of the ants, workers don't even have ovaries. So there appears to be like no opportunity. They're stuck. They're at the point of no return. They can't go back. That's a superorganism because there's no real opportunity for reproductive competition in those colonies. However, when we look at the case of the honeybee, there's a subspecies, Apis mellifera capensis. It's also called the Cape honeybee, that exists only in a very small area in the very tip of South Africa. This is an area that has a lot of wind regularly. It has a high frequency of queens getting lost. So the swarm leaves the nest, a new virgin queen emerges, they go through their fights, and they, you know, and then one emerges as the victor, and she goes off to mate in order to come back. She sequesters away the sperm of the male. She has her ovaries sequestering her eggs, comes back, and she starts laying eggs and forms a new colony. But there's a high chance that the queen, because of the wind, won't make it back. So there's a high rate of colonies becoming queenless. They lose their queens. So this population has evolved special characteristics that are associated with this high queen loss. First of all, they have a high they develop thalidiki. Thalidiki is a mechanism of parthenogenesis, whereby females can lay eggs that are unfertilized and they turn into females, they turn into workers. Now, most cases, unfertilized eggs in honeybees and most hymenoptera, the unfertilized eggs turn into males. Males are derived from the unfertilized eggs. It's a kind of parthenogenesis called aeronautiki. But in this particular population, they've evolved this thalidiki is a very high, at a high, very high frequency, which results in producing these individuals, these workers can lay eggs that produce individuals that are identical to them with respect to their genetic complement. So they're producing clones. So one individual worker can lay eggs, can develop her ovaries in the absence of the queen, can lay eggs, and she can produce offspring that are identical to her, which then can also produce female offspring that are identical to them. And so you can get these clonal populations that grow. When a colony loses its queen and the workers develop their ovarials so that they can lay eggs, and they start laying eggs that are going to turn into females, those workers, females, it's hard to call them a worker, but those false queens or whatever that emerge out of them, they will then leave the nest, they'll fly off, and they'll fly into another colony or another nest. So in the case of an apiary might lose, a colony might lose its queen. It develops these thalidicus workers who then disperse, and they go in and invade colonies that are viable, that have viable queens, and they go in and they start laying eggs. And so then they lay eggs that then produce their daughters who lay eggs and produce daughters. And eventually, this clone will spread inside of this colony like a cancer. And it will consume the resources, and they don't do any work. They consume the resources, and after a while, they'll kill the queen. And then this colony just produces more and more and more of these clonal social parasites that leave and invade other nests until the colony uses up all of its resources and it collapses and dies, and it's gone. So this is a kind of social parasitism that suggests that perhaps there is a point of no return. I mean, no, they don't return back to the point of founding a nest on their own, but there are additional reproductive options for them even after they've reached this point that that was the point of no return with respect to the evolution of the reproductive traits in the society. In 1993, Sandy Mitchell, a philosopher, and I wrote a paper, and it was called The Superorganism, New Perspective or Tired Metaphor. And we said that instead of reviving and formulating an old idiosyncratic paradigm, social insect biologists should embrace a view of insect societies as dynamic, self-organized systems that are subject to hierarchical levels of selection. This was our thought. Again, in this sense, we were agreeing with Ed Wilson of 1971. You know, we can move beyond this. We don't really need to be embracing these old ideas. We have other things that we can embrace that are a better way of viewing super or viewing a social insect society rather than the superorganism metaphor or concept. However, in a recent book that I wrote, I ended up devoting half the book to the superorganism. So I think it's still a big question. Is it a new perspective or a tired metaphor?